Welcome, everyone. It's so glad to see you all here tonight for Let's Dance, a very special Thursday Scholarship Series Piano Extravaganza. It's wonderful to see all of you here. This is a great audience. If you love piano, this is the concert for you. If you don't like piano, hopefully come back and see one of our other concerts. No, we think you're going to love it tonight. And we're really glad to have you here. This is a really special event for the Hugh Hodgson School of Music and the piano area. Some of you know that we've done these in the past. The last one was done during the pandemic, so it was virtual only. We did this whole program and videotaped different segments and then stitched them together and put them up online. So the last live one that we've done was well over 5 years ago. So we're really happy to be back here doing this program for you. I'm Pete Jutras. I am the director of the Hugh Hodgson School of Music. I'm going to be, so to speak, the Kermit for this Muppet show that's happening here tonight behind, and I'll try to kind of guide you through it. I'm going to try to share some numbers with you throughout the course of the evening, and the first number is 440. That's an important number in music. You may or may not know that 440 is the frequency in hertz of the tuning note that you always hear orchestras tune to. That's an A. So when the concertmaster walks out and plays an A, that's 440. That also happens to be the number of piano keys on these five grand pianos behind me. So 440 keys tonight. I don't think you're going to hear all 440 of them at the same time, but there are some pieces where you're going to hear a lot of them together. So let's dance. The piano and keyboard instruments in general have a long history of connection to dance music. The oldest surviving piano music in the world that is known is in a book called the Roberts Bridge Codex, and this was published in 1320, or it was put on paper in 1320. That book has a handful of keyboard pieces, and there are some dance pieces in there. There are three pieces called Estampi, which is a dance of the Italian Trecento. So dance music is in the oldest book ever known. Now, if you go forward a couple hundred years, the Fitzwilliam Virginal book collects music from the 1500s and 1600s. That's also one of the oldest sources we have. And again, lots and lots of dance music in the Fitzwilliam Virginal book. We move forward to the Baroque period and Bach, and many of his most famous pieces were dances, from the really simple minuets that every student plays, to his really big partitas and French suites and English suites. So we're pianists. We're not going to dance for you because we're not very good at that. You definitely don't want to see me dance. But we are going to play a lot from this rich history of dance music, and it's going to cover three different centuries. So to get us started, the first piece you're going to hear tonight is a minuet from the classical era. And this was written by Franz Joseph Haydn, a very famous composer. This is actually transcribed from his 100th symphony, the Military Symphony. Haydn wrote a lot of symphonies. This is one of his London symphonies. So it was premiered in 1794 in London with Haydn sitting at the piano for the premiere. He conducted from the piano. The minuet is a very, very popular and common dance in three. We see it all the time in the Baroque and classical periods. So that was 1794. It seems hard to believe, maybe, but it's only 100 years later, 105 to be exact, that Scott Joplin releases the Maple Leaf Rag. So that was copyrighted in 1899, and that was one of Joplin's earliest works. So it kind of launched his fame and led to his reputation as the king of ragtime. And it doesn't seem like anyone is sure, and I'm not an official ragtime scholar, but it appears that a lot of people think it may be named after the Maple Leaf Club, which was in Sedalia, Missouri, and Joplin played there a lot as a pianist, so that may be the title. Some scholars aren't terribly sure about that. Ragtime was kind of a fusion or a mishmash of classical march rhythm, which was very straight, and syncopated jazz rhythm over top of that. So you hear a lot of steady work in the bass and syncopated jazz rhythms going on over that. It grew to be very, very popular at the turn of the century in America, although in an interview, Joplin himself said that, ragtime's been here since African people came to America. It's just that white society didn't take notice of it until the 1890s and the 1900s. So it's a form of music that's been around for a long, long time. And people dance to rags, just like they dance to minuets. So they were very common. They had a big influence on dance bands of the time. They led to a lot of different steps. And if you look at the covers of Joplin's music, you see sometimes you see words like a two-step or a cakewalk or certain kinds of dances that go along with the ragtime. So I hope that you will enjoy as much as we have enjoyed preparing the first two selections on our program, Haydn's Minuet from Symphony No. 100 and Scott Joplin's Maple Leaf Rag. Please welcome our first performers. So living about the same time as Scott Joplin was a French music scholar named Alexandre Jean-Albert Lavignac. And you'll note that I said music scholar, not composer. Lavignac studied at the Paris Conservatory, where he later taught theory and harmony. He had some fairly famous students in his class. One was the composer Vincent Dendy, and the other was someone you might have heard of, maybe Claude Debussy? Yeah. Interesting fact about Lavignac, he famously characterized each major and minor key with what he thought were their inherent colors or characteristics. So, checks notes, C major, according to Lavignac, was simple and naive, while F sharp major was rough and rude. Sorry, F sharp major. Wait, what's this? I told you it was a Muppet show. There are 94 hands playing on this concert. That's 470 fingers and 1,764 joints. They're not all playing at the same time, and they're typically spread out amongst this great array of pianos here. But for this Lavignac Gallop March, we're going to put 8 hands on one piano, which doesn't leave them very much space. So this is a fun piece. You're gonna see the choreography that students have to do to get everything to fit here. D major, by the way, Lavignac said, is joyful and brilliant. So see if you agree with that. The pianists are going to employ some special and unique talents on display, like unicycle riding. And I want to give a special shout out to these performers. They are all first and second year students. Our next piece comes from the world of opera, but this is not just any opera. Orfeo and Eurydice, which premiered in 1762, is the first of Christoph Willibald Gluck's reform operas. And this opera, along with others at the time, was an effort to return the art form to a more integrated show that put together the drama, the story, the music, and elements of dance. The idea being that opera had maybe drifted away from its roots into more of a showcase for pure vocal technique. So Orfeo and Eurydice tells the ancient story of Orpheus in the underworld, and it contains significant elements of dance and ballet throughout the production. So please enjoy two of our wonderful doctoral students performing this ballet from Gluck's groundbreaking opera. So I think you can see already that the piano department at the Hugh Hodgson School of Music is a really vibrant, exciting place with world-class students and world-class faculty. We have over 60 piano majors at the moment, seven faculty. There are over 120 pianos in our inventory at the School of Music and here in the Performing Arts Center. So there's always a lot going on. Every week, that's more than 60 lessons and coachings. And though those happen in individual studios, the department often bands together for master classes with guest artists, competitions, festivals, conferences, and even trips to the Steinway Factory in New York City and performances at Steinway Hall. And as a sometime member of the piano faculty, when they'll have me on the faculty, I'm always grateful for how collegial our students are. They don't argue, they're not hyper-competitive like some institutions. They're always supportive of each other. And excuse me, apparently I've been handed an important announcement here. What? Who's running things back there? Apparently there's a big argument between the students backstage. They're fighting and they can't reconcile their differences. So that makes the director look good with what he was just saying. This note tells me the students are about to come to blows back there, and they think the only way they can solve this is through a good old-fashioned piano battle. So I think you in the audience, you're going to be asked to vote on this battle, so please pay attention. We'll bring you in a moment. But yeah, I guess that's what's going to happen. So they're ready to perform. So our first entry in this piano battle is performing Aram Khachaturian's Saber Dance from his ballet, Guyane. Please welcome the first group in our piano battle.
Thank you.
So that was group number one. The second group in our piano battle is performing Waltz of the Flowers from perhaps the most famous ballet of all, Tchaikovsky's Nutcracker. Please welcome group number two.
Thank you.
you don't have to go way over there. Like, so the piano, dance, battle gauntlets have been thrown down. We have two ballets from Russian composers, arguably the most famous pieces either of those composers ever wrote. So you all told me there's only one way to settle this. Audience, your applause will determine the winner of our piano dance battle. So choose wisely. Let's give it up for Saber Dance. Let's hear it for Waltz of the Flowers. Well, guys, I thought maybe we'd have a tie, but apparently flowers are pretty hard to beat. So actually, what I said about our students is really true. They are a wonderfully collegial, supportive group. Other than the occasional piano battle, they get along really well and work together beautifully, which makes our jobs wonderful. They're all winners. Please give a big round of applause for We're going to take a brief intermission. You're welcome to get up and stretch your dancing legs, and we'll be back for the second half. Welcome back to our second half. So the number now is 5,320. That is the number of pounds of piano that's up here. That's 2.66 tons if you'd prefer to keep score that way, and five pianos. These pianos are so heavy because they have massive cast iron frames, and collectively these piano frames are holding 226,000 pounds of string tension, which is 113 tons if you want to keep score that way. Each of the pianos has over 12,000 distinct parts, so there are 60,000 different parts being played up here. And we're going to use a lot of those parts, maybe all of those parts, in the next few pieces. We have a set of dance-related pieces that are in jazz and contemporary style. And if you'll indulge me for a moment or two, I'm going to tell you about the next four pieces and get out of the way and just let them flow one to each other. So, the great American jazz pianist and composer Dave Brubeck was on a quartet tour in Poland in 1958. So, this is Cold War behind the Iron Curtain. And the bleak winter landscape that he encountered inspired him to compose a melancholy theme. And to make a long story short, this theme grew into a tune that became very popular in Poland. And he was approached by a choreographer to create a ballet out of this music. This led to the ballet Points on Jazz, which was published in 1961. And you're going to hear the prelude from Points on Jazz performed by two of our amazing faculty members, James Weidman and Lisa Stepanova. The next piece is a jazz bossa nova based on Pachelbel's famous canon in D major. Now, I'll note that this is transposed to C major. That would make Lavignac happy, right? Because he said that was a nice simple key. So you got to pay attention. The canon was not a dance, but the bossa nova definitely is. It's a Brazilian rhythm that originated as a cool jazz variant on the samba. And it wasn't long before people were dancing to it and adding specific dance steps called the bossa nova in the 1950s and 60s. We think Pachelbel would approve. This piece is going to be performed by two of our undergraduate students who are both in their third year of study. So, if we're going to talk about bossa nova, why not go right to the source? Our third piece in the set is called Corcovado, and it's by the Brazilian composer Antonio Carlos Jobim. Born in Rio, Jobim was a bar and nightclub pianist who got his first big break writing the music to a Brazilian setting of Orpheus. Same story that we heard in the Gluck setting earlier tonight. This led to some attention and success, and an eventual collaboration with the renowned saxophonist Stan Getz and the Brazilian singer João Gilberto. They released an album called Getz Gilberto, and it featured the song Corcovado. This was the first jazz album to win the Grammy for Best Overall Album. The music on the album caused a sensation, and you might recognize one of the other groundbreaking tunes from the album, also written by Jobim, The Girl from Ipanema. Jobim single-handedly kind of created the bossa nova craze, and he is known as the father of the bossa nova. So that piece, Corcovado, is going to be performed by jazz piano faculty member Greg Satterthwaite and student Michael Solomon. The last piece in our four-piece jazz contemporary set is by Eleanor Alberga, a living composer from Jamaica. She was born in Kingston and she studied at the Jamaica School of Music. In 1970, she won a scholarship to study at the Royal Academy of Music in London, a pretty good music school. That move proved to be pivotal in Alberga's life. She's currently a guest lecturer at the Royal Academy. She is a living composer, and her works have been performed by the Royal Philharmonic and the London Philharmonic Orchestras. Apropos to our dance program here tonight, Alberga is also the music director for the London Contemporary Dance Theater. So you're going to hear Star Dance from Hill and Gully Ride for two pianos. Alberga wrote this in 1990, and it draws on her Jamaican background with playful rhythms. We'll hear four of our doctoral students performing this work. So please enjoy these four jazz and contemporary dance works, beginning with Dave Brubeck's prelude from Points on Jazz. So the next number I have for you tonight is 47. There are 47 different performers on the program tonight, which takes a fair amount of coordination. We got 32 students and 8 faculty. I was doing so good with the numbers to this point. Must be getting late in the evening. Actually, where do the other 7 come from? We have 7 really special guest performers tonight from our UGA Community Music School. And the Community Music School is a part of the Hugh Hodgson School of Music. It's a very important part. And yes, they know how to have fun. Students of any age from, you know, very, very young to very, very old, and any size as well, I guess that's not the same as age, who want to learn almost any instrument can take lessons at our community music school. And you all kind of gasped a little when I said we have 60 piano majors in college right now. We have 81 piano students in our community music school, and over 350 community music school students right now. If you're inspired by what's happening here on stage tonight and you think you'd like to take some lessons, please look us up. It's a very, very fun place to be. If you add up all those community music school lessons with all the UGA piano lessons and multiply it by the weeks in the year, we figure, we're not totally sure, and you saw that I'm not that good at addition, about 4,000 piano lessons a year happening right here. And we're very proud of that because more people playing piano and making music makes the world a better place. And that is true, and I believe that very much. So tonight, these 7 CMS students, along with their teachers, are here to perform the very popular balloon pop polka. And that's written for 8 hands, but we thought we'd go ahead and do it with 18 hands tonight. Why not? If it's worth doing, it's worth doing bigger, right? And that's a lot of balloons to pop. We've been through plenty of them in our rehearsal. And a fair warning, there will be some loud noises in this part of our performance. So if we are ready, please welcome these wonderful Community Music School students and the balloon pop polka. Thank you. Last number of the evening, 1.1, 1.1 million to be exact. Retail value of the five pianos that you hear, see here on stage. Little over $200,000 a piece if you want to buy a new 9-foot Steinway grand from the factory. We think the experience of performing on these pianos in this hall, teaching our students in our studios is priceless. And there are two people in particular that we want to thank for making that possible. We have two amazing full-time technicians on staff who are truly among the best in the world at what they do. And that's why these pianos always sound in their best shape in these concerts that you hear. But what you don't hear is that they always sound amazing in the practice rooms and in our studios. So please join me in giving a big round of applause to Scott Higgins and Tony Graves, our amazing piano technicians. I also want to thank our piano faculty. As you might imagine, there's a lot of work that goes into a program like this, a lot of organizing, a lot of rehearsing, a lot of herding 47 different people to get to the right spot and be in the right place backstage. So please help me thank the piano faculty for all their efforts as well. So that brings us to the final piece on our program. Maurice Ravel's Bolero for 16 hands. The entire piano faculty is going to perform this, and since there's only seven of us right now, we are pleased to have a very special guest artist, Professor Emeritus Martha Thomas, join us to be hands number 15 and 16. Many of you know that Dr. Thomas is an amazing teacher, and she had an incredible career here at the Hugh Hodgson School of Music, influencing so many lives. Written in 1928, Bolero is one of Ravel's last completed works. He finished it just before illness forced him into retirement from composing. It was commissioned by the dancer Ida Rubinstein, and while you're probably used to hearing Bolero played by an orchestra, the premiere in Paris was actually a ballet with ballet dancing. The Bolero is a very popular Spanish dance form, and the choreographer and designer from that Paris premiere put the following language in the program to set the scene. I'm going to read that to you. Inside a tavern in Spain, people dance beneath the brass lamp hung from the ceiling. In response to the cheers to join in, the female dancer has leapt onto the long table and her steps become more and more animated. So you can imagine that when we're performing. The world has a love-hate relationship with this piece. Ravel intentionally set out to write a piece of music that featured a theme that didn't change, didn't modulate, just repeated over and over again, and he wanted to create interest through changing the instruments of the orchestra. There's a story about the premiere. It may be apocryphal, but the story goes that at the premiere, after the first performance of the piece, a woman from the audience shouted out, "You're mad!" And Ravel replied, "You understood the piece exactly." It's one of the most popular classical pieces of all time, and that popularity is probably something that rubs some people the wrong way. One French critic famously lamented that somewhere in the world, somebody starts Bolero every 10 minutes. And because the piece is 17 minutes long, that means Bolero is always playing. It never stops. Whether you love Bolero or hate it, we think this is the performance for you. If you love it, it's Bolero, and it's for 16 hands. If you're not a fan of the repetitive nature of Bolero, we have a special treat in this version. Our jazz piano faculty, James Weidman and Greg Satterthwaite, are each gonna improvise. And so you're gonna hear something different. And I've heard them rehearse, and it's different every time. So we won't have the same repetition that you always have. You will hear something new. I meant to mention earlier that $1.1 million. I know we have donors in the audience, and we are so grateful for your support. I know we have donors in the audience that contributed directly to help with the purchase of some of these instruments. So we are very grateful for that. Your ticket proceeds tonight all go to support student scholarships, and most, if not all, of the students on stage tonight are on some form of scholarship or assistantship. So thank you as always for your support. I hope you enjoy this performance of Bolero, and please stick around after Bolero to help us give applause to all 47 performers. We're gonna try and see if we can round them up and get them on stage. Thank you.